Friends, how are you? Today we are going to start part number 3 of the Mughal Empire. And we'll start this video with the topic Mansabdars and Jagirdars. So many times you listen this word Mansabdars and Jagirdars. But sometimes it is making confusion for the students to understand the difference between Jagirdars and Mansabdars and proper meaning of Mansabdars or Jagirdars. So I hope today in this video you will listen carefully, watch this video completely, and after watching the video I hope that you will definitely understand the meaning of Mansabdars and Jagirdars. First of all, we'll take the word meaning of Mansabdar. Mansabdar is the combination of two words. Mansabdar, Mansab plus da. Mansab is related to a rank or position. Position. It was a rank or position during the Mughal Empire. Dar means holder or official. Official or the holder of Mansab. So Mansab was a post. It was a rank or position, and dar means the person who is holding mansab. So mansabdar, holder of mansab. It means the holder of this rank or position called mansabdar. Mansabdari system or jagirdari system. Jagirdar, jagir is the piece of land. Jagir is the piece of land. Dar means holder. But in jagirdari system, the land, piece of land was not given permanently to the jagirdar. We'll discuss in this video, right? Further, first of all, let's start the topic. Mansabdar. This system was started by Akbar. Right? This system was started by Akbar during the Mughal Empire. To combine or mixed up military responsibility and civil. So under the Mansabdari system, military and civil responsibilities of the employees or the service people was combined. The responsibility of military and civil was combined. So this is the main feature. Second feature, during the Mansabdari system, the Mansabdars were provided with the salaries or the jagirs. Let's understand in detail. Mansab was a rank, right? So it was related to three things. Number one, rank. Number two, salary. And number three, military responsibility. Responsibilities, military responsibilities. So it was rank. What rank of Mansab? So what rank of Mansab? It was based on two things. How many jats and how many sawar, right? How many sawar, how many jats were held by Mansab? It was dependent on his rank. So what is the rank of Mansab? All the Mansabdars were not equal, right? All the Mansabdars were not equal in their position. Some Mansabdars were very big. Some Mansabdars were small Mansabdars, understand, were having less jat. Jat was means it was numerical digit, and it means, jat means how many soldiers were kept by this rank holder. How many soldiers were kept by Mansabdar, understand? So it was called jat. For example, 1000, 500, multiply by 10. This numerical digit was counted, multiply by 10, 1000 zats, 2000, 5000. The mansabdars who were having more than 5000 or more than 4000 were big mansabdars. But those mansabdars were having less number of jats were small mansabdars, and their salary and jagirs were according to their rank. And how many sawar means horsemen, the soldiers were on the back of horses. So how many sawars were there means within the mansabdars, with the mansabdars. So it was means deciding factor of the rank of mansabdar. Most of the people, those who are very close to the royal people, for example Akbar or Aurangzeb and their courtmen, so they used to get the big mansabdaris, understand, big mansabs, and they became big mansabdars. Clear? So rank, do you understand what is rank? Mansabdar, three things about mansabdar. Number one, rank. Rank was dependent on jats and sawars. After that, salary. Mansabdars were provided with the salary. Salary in cash, right? Or if they are not provided with the salary as cash, they were provided with a piece of land. And this land was known as jagir. Clear? So it is integral part. Jagirdari system is the integral part of mansabdari system. Mansabdari and Jagirdari are not so much different, because Jagirdari system is the integral part of Mansabdari system. You will have to understand that Mansabdars were dependent on their rank, and according to the rank, they were given their salary. And salary was given in two forms. One as cash, other as land. Getting my point? If they were provided with the cash, and they were provided with the salary, considering two important things. What things? Because they had these soldiers, jat and sawars, understand? So to maintain this sena or this army or this military, they needed money, and this money was provided by the samrat, or we can say emperor, and as cash, otherwise as land. So for his own salary and plus maintenance of military. So for this purpose they were provided with the salary as cash, otherwise as land. So if the salary was provided with the land, so this land was called jagir, and in this way those mansabdars used to get land, piece of land, for collection of revenue. Why this land was provided to the jagirdars, to the mansabdars? To collect revenue. You have to remember, dear students, they did not become the owner of that land. Getting my point? They were not permanently owner of that land. Just they used to get the land for only for collection of revenue, because as salary, because they were not provided with the cash, so they were provided with the piece of land to collect revenue and to maintain the expenditure of jats and sawars, and they had to use as their salary. So only this thing. So in the jagirdari system was the part of mansabdaris. All the mansabdars were not jagirdars. Clear? All the mansabdars were not jagirdars, because jagirdars were the mansabs or the officials only, those who used to be provided with the land for revenue collection. And as I told you that they were not permanently owner of land, just they used to get the land temporarily only to collect revenue. And these mansabs were changed time to time. Understand? They were transferred time to time. For example, this Jagir A was provided with 2 Mansabdar 1 and B 2 Mansabdar 2. After some time, because entire control was in hands of Mughal Emperor, the entire control was in hands of Mughal Emperor, and The power was completely centralized in Mughal emperor, so he could change. So after some time, the Mughal emperor used to give the mansabdari A to mansabdar second and mansabdari B to one. Understand? So in this way, they used to be transferred time to time, and entire powers were in hands of the Mughal emperor. So this was the system about rank, salary and military responsibility. So I hope that you are getting my point. Jagirdars were having jagirs, and they were not provided with the salary as cash, so they provided with the land, and on that land they used to collect the revenue to have the expenditure to maintain the military and other kinds of expenditures. So this was the mansabdari and jagirdari system, and these were the mansabdars and jagirdars. Clear? The most of the beneficial things of the Mughal empire, that military and civil were combined, and now the Mughal emperor had extra military. Understand? Whenever Mughal emperor needed, then mansabdars or jagirdars were ready with their military or with their army. So dear students, this was the mansabdari and jagirdari system during the Mughal empire duration, and it was started by Akbar. So now, after the discussion of jagirdars and mansabdars, we'll discuss about Jabt and Zamindars. Jabt and Zamindars. You know that the Mughal rulers was based on tax. The source of income, the main source of income was the tax on the produce of the peasantry. In most places, peasants paid taxes through the rural elites. Rural elites means higher classes people in rural area, or the influencing people, right? That is the headman or the local chiefman. And the Mughals used one term, zamindars, for these kinds of people. For example, the peasants used to pay the taxes to the headman, and this headman was called by Mughals zamindar. Clear? He had the control over that particular area in which the peasants used to grow the crops, and he used to collect the tax and given to the Mughal emperor. So to describe all intermediaries, whether they were local headmen of villages or powerful chieftains, so were known as zamindars. The revenue minister of Akbar, Todarmal, started a system. This system was known as Jabti system. And what did he do? He held a survey of crop yields, prices and areas cultivated for 10 years period, 1570 to 1580, this 10 year period. On the basis of this data, tax was fixed on each crop in cash. You have to remember, in cash. In Jabti system, the tax was decided in cash. Each province was divided into revenue circles with its own schedule of revenue rates for individual crops. This revenue system was known as Jabti system. It was prevalent in those areas where Mughal administrators could survey the land and keep very careful accounts. Dear students, you have to remember that this system was not applicable in all areas. Clear? This was not possible in provinces such as Gujarat and Bengal, because these were very far from the center of Mughals. In some areas, the zamindars exercised a great deal of power. The exploitation of Mughal administrators and by Mughal administrators could drive them to rebellion. And sometimes zamindars and peasants of the same caste allied in rebelling against Mughal authority. So these peasant revolts challenged the stability of Mughal empire from the end of the 17th century. So as conclusion, we can say that Jabti system caused some kinds of rebellious activities against the Mughal empire. Clear? So this was about Jabti system and zamindari system. Let's have a look on Akbarnama. Aine Akbari. Akbar ordered one of his close friends and courtiers, Abul Fazl was the friend of Akbar, to write a history of his reign, about his government, about his ruling period. Abul Fazl wrote a 3-volume history of Akbar's reign titled
अकबर नामा. सो यू हैव टू रिमेंबर दैट अकबर नामा वॉज रिटन इन टू इन थ्री वॉल्यूम्स. इन द फर्स्ट वॉल्यूम अकबर्स एंसेस्टर्स एंड द सेकेंड वॉल्यूम रिकॉर्डेड द इवेंट्स ऑफ अकबर्स राइन. थर्ड वॉल्यूम इज इन आयन ए अकबरी. इट डील्स विद अकबर्स एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन सिस्टम हाउसहोल्ड आर्मी रेवेन्यूज एंड ज्योग्राफी ऑफ हिज एम्पायर. इट ऑल्सो provides rich details about the traditions and culture of the people living in India during Mughal Empire. The most interesting aspect about the Ayn-e-Akbari is its rich statistical details about things as diverse as crops, yields, prices, wages and revenue. So in this way, this is very important literary book written by Abul Fazl during Mughal Empire period. In this figure, you can see that at that time also bribes used to be taken by the officials in the first figure, and tax collector punishing poor peasants at that time. So these things also were in practice during Mughal Empire. So dear students, these were the topics of this video. I hope that you understood. If you still have doubt, you can ask me by writing in comment box. Thank you. Have a nice day.